evening and welcome to Vibrant Hong Kong. I'm Mishy.
And I'm Rico. Good evening, everyone.
Rico, did you know that during the 1960s, Hong Kong was a prolific exporter of textiles, watches, electronics and toys? The Made in Hong Kong label was like a badge of excellence, representing top-notch quality and affordability.
Absolutely, Mishy. Those were indeed the glory days of Hong Kong's manufacturing industry. But there's no need to reminisce about the past as our city is entering an exciting new era of industrialization, fueled by cutting-edge technologies and the spirit of innovation.
In the Chief Executive's 2023 policy address, there was a strong emphasis on advancing new industrialization to drive economic growth through innovation and technology. Measures included the establishment of a 10 billion Hong Kong dollar new industrialization acceleration scheme and the creation of the new industrialization development office.
At the Hong Kong Got Industry Strategic Alliance Showcase, organized by the Hong Kong Productivity Council last month, the Hong Kong Innovation, Technology and Industry Bureau announced an optimized funding plan, which will enable companies engaged in new industrialization to undertake three projects simultaneously and receive a maximum of 45 million Hong Kong dollars in funding.
Entrepreneurs from over 40 multinational and local companies also shared their success stories at this event, highlighting how HKPC's support has propelled them into this era of new industrial development.
3, 2, 1 Hong Kong's prowess in innovation and technology took center stage as over 40 multinational and local companies across different sectors gathered at the Hong Kong Got Industries Strategic Alliance Showcase. Organized by the Hong Kong Productivity Council, the event served as a platform for industry leaders to share how they've been able to progress towards new industrialization with government support and HKPC's instrumental assistance.
Today is a very exciting day for us at HKPC. We are trying to promote what we call Hong Kong has industries. For industrial development in Hong Kong, especially in the past 5 years, it has been evolving quite a lot. The traditional ones is more about upgrading. We can see there is a deployment of new technology from i4.0. You can see robotics, AI. And the other part of the industry is really the emerging industry. High-tech industries relies a lot more on the new incoming support from the government. HKPC has been in Hong Kong for 56 years already. So our job is to support industrial development. To make this happen, you need investment. So how do we support the company to apply for Hong Kong government funding?
With the support of HKPC, traditional industries are undergoing a remarkable transformation through new industrialization. Welding processes have been revolutionized, leveraging digitalization and robotics to enhance safety and efficiency.
Now, the first robot we got is what we call off-site robot, mainly for the foundation, very heavy piling, which is several tons of one pile. We installed about 2 to 3 years ago, and then we think about more portable robot during last year. Yeah, and we work with Hong Kong PC for this part. And so we want a uniformity of quality, and definitely using robot to weld can enhance and ensure the quality control. If you talk about the productivity, it will be 3 times, can work faster. We have actually save about at least 30% of the cost. And then not to save the cost in productivity, not to say about the repeating the quality control. So we believe that robotic welding should be the trend as we further develop on.
Meanwhile, another Made in Hong Kong brand has elevated its production capabilities through smart technology. With HKPC's assistance, they've established a smart production line to enhance capacity and output stability, achieving a 9-fold increase in production while extending machinery lifespan.
Our company has been making juice since 2010, so we've been hand-making bottle juice with low productivities. We are looking for to increase our productivities by using automations. So we introduced a new product line to Hong Kong. So previously, with the old filling lines, we can only do 1,000 bottles per day. So with the new designed production line, we can do 10,000 bottles per day. Also, we have a new sterilization system that helps us to extend the expiry day of the product from 10 days to 19 days nowadays. Yeah. With the extent of the expiry date, I'm hoping to export my products to China or to some nearby countries like Singapore, like Malaysia, like Thailand, etc.
While innovation and technology are key drivers for boosting economic growth in Hong Kong, attracting and retaining foreign investment as well as helping overseas and mainland businesses expand in Hong Kong also holds strategic importance for the city's economic development. As the government department responsible for facilitating foreign direct investment, Invest Hong Kong plays an instrumental role in these efforts.
Invest Hong Kong aims to strengthen Hong Kong's status as an international business hub by providing support to foreign and mainland entrepreneurs, SMEs, and multinational corporations interested in investing in the city. Tonight, we have the privilege of speaking with the newly appointed Director General of Invest Hong Kong, Ms. Alpha Lau. Welcome to the show to share her vision and plans for 2024 with us.
Thank you for having me, Michi, Rico.
Thank you. Well, firstly, congratulations on your appointment. But could you first by telling us how did you came to join the Invest Hong Kong and also take on this special role?
I studied in the UK for a good 10 years. After I graduated, I decided to come back to Hong Kong to work, and Hong Kong being an international financial center, I joined the banking sector. Mm-hmm. For 20 years, I've worked in various banks, both foreign and Chinese, in variable areas, and from frontline to back office. And then later, I also went to the fintech sector. Now, I first learned about Invest Hong Kong when I was their client, you know, because I brought a foreign bank into Hong Kong, and I needed help to set it up here, to look for an office space, to look at the regulations required, what licenses you needed. And the Invest Hong Kong team were very professional in giving me a lot of help and guidance as to how to do this. So I was very impressed with the professionalism. Mm. And that's how I came to know Invest Hong Kong.
I think that is really like good to hear. And it's always great to work with a team that you have worked with before.
Right.
But now you have like the 360 approach and a perspective. So I think that would really help you do an excellent job.
Yes.
So I'm sure it's been quite a journey and experience moving from the private sector to the public one. So what's your vision for Invest Hong Kong and its role in promoting Hong Kong as a global business hub?
Well, Hong Kong is a global business hub, but do enough people know about it? Now, Invest Hong Kong's job is to really let the world know what a great place Hong Kong is to do business. So we already run a lot of events in Hong Kong, large-scale events such as Start Me Up, Green Fintech Week, Wealth for Good, etc. And we're going to do even more promotion activities outside of Hong Kong this year. So Invest Hong Kong needs to really let the world know and to rediscover Hong Kong as the place to do business.
So since you mentioned events, I'd like to follow up on that. What exciting events does Invest Hong Kong have in store in the coming months for the general public to participate in?
Oh, we have a series of events coming up in this quarter, in fact, which are very exciting. Now, Hong Kong has always been known as a finance hub. So as I mentioned earlier, we have Fintech Week later on in the year, but in March, a big event coming is called ComplexCon, which is funded by the Mega Fund. And it is actually a hip-hop culture event that's come from Los Angeles. And it's going to be very exciting for, and of course, also coming in March is Art Basel, which Invest Hong Kong helped bring into Hong Kong years back. And it's become a very interesting event for art lovers of Hong Kong.
Well, Rico, I think it's quite reassuring to know that Hong Kong is still a super connector and the financial hub for international businesses.
For sure, we got tons of potential and a lot of opportunities. But in your opinion, what are the key factors that make Hong Kong an attractive destination for investment?
Hong Kong is a great place to do business in, not only because of its stable legal framework, the fact that you could have financing and liquidity easily, and such a vibrant business environment, and people from all over the world coming to Hong Kong. Now, that we already know, and that's a very, very exciting fact. But I also want people to know that, you know, when you do business in Hong Kong, you also need it to be a good place to live in. And Hong Kong is a wonderful and vibrant place. As I tell businesses who come in, well, Hong Kong has the highest concentration of Michelin star restaurants in the world. And of course, we also have our famous dim sum eateries. And nightlife here is very vibrant as well. So if you like food and beverage, if you like a vibrant nightlife, this is the place to be. And other than that, you know, Hong Kong, where else in the world could you take a 20-minute tram ride or a train ride and go hiking? 70% of green trails and a beautiful coastline, 20 minutes to the beach. So, you know, you have to live as well as do business. It's a great place to be in.
Definitely. I mean, work-life balance, right? I mean, we have beautiful nature and, you know, we actually talked about it earlier, how you can actually roll within the city. That's really amazing.
Yes, Hong Kong actually hosted the World Coastal Rowing Championships a few years ago. You can row out in the middle of a Victoria Harbour, right in the middle of the city, and you can row all the way to the south of the island or further afield into Sai Kung, etc., where you're then suddenly surrounded by miles of beautiful coastlines as well as greenery. So it's actually a very amazing place to be in.
Well, that all sounds very promising. Now let's talk about the statistics and numbers. Mm-hmm. So could you share some highlights with us?
Invest Hong Kong helped 382 companies successfully set up offices in Hong Kong last year. And with these companies, we created 4,100 jobs, as well as brought in foreign direct investments of 61.6 billion in the last year. So we're quite happy to have created these opportunities, not only for the companies, but also for the Hong Kong population.
And it's already a new year. So could you tell us about Invest Hong Kong's work focus for 2024? And also, like, what kind of strategies will you employ to attract more overseas companies to establish regional headquarters in Hong Kong?
Invest Hong Kong's setup is both by geography as well as industry. In the Hong Kong headquarters, we have 9 industry teams specializing in fintech, in tourism, and all the other industries that are very key to the Hong Kong economy. At the same time, we also have 33 global offices around the world in key cities, so that we are able to let the population and businesses not yet in Hong Kong know about Hong Kong. So in the coming year, or in this year, in 2024, what we really want to do is to further improve the knowledge of Hong Kong, the information about Hong Kong as the global destination hub for doing business, particularly in newer markets like Southeast Asia and the Middle East.
So there are already 33 offices. Do you guys have plan to expand a little bit further into the globe?
Yes, of course. It's already been announced in the policy address that we will further open 2 offices in the Belt and Road region. Mm-hmm. So we want to further expand our foothold in these areas. Invest Hong Kong works with a lot of partners. Other than government bureaus, we also work very closely with consulate generals in Hong Kong, as well as chambers of commerce. Mm-hmm. To get other businesses to know Hong Kong better, we have to work with all these agencies or partners. And I myself have to travel a fair bit, quite a lot, to these various countries, particularly going forward in the Middle East, as well as Southeast Asia, but also to Europe and beyond, so people could know more about Hong Kong. And it's a very, very fun job, because Hong Kong is such a marvelous place.
So let's talk a little bit about the specifics of Invest Hong Kong's work. How do you assist an overseas or mainland investor seeking to establish in Hong Kong? Could you provide us some of the steps?
We provide an end-to-end service. So, for example, when a company is first interested in expanding into Asia or into Hong Kong, for example, so we'll let them know about the general business environment, if they're in a particular industry that requires licenses, what are the regulations there that need to be looked at and to get approvals in. We also go all the way into helping our businesses look for schools for the children, for example, or how to get working visas for their staff to come into Hong Kong. And we all do one-stop shop, including looking for locations for the places, help them with the publicity. So we do an all-in-all one-stop shop for companies looking to come to Hong Kong, and it's completely free of charge.
Are there specific qualifications or like a limited type of businesses that they can do, or is it pretty much unlimited?
Well, Hong Kong is a free port, and we have every industry possible. There's absolutely no limit as to what type of company you want to open here. Now, of course, there are areas of focus that we would like to further develop for Hong Kong, such as artificial intelligence, life sciences, fintech, and advanced manufacturing. Mm-hmm. So in these four areas, we place particular focus to help industries who are in these areas of expertise to come into Hong Kong.
Now, with the resumption of normal travel between Hong Kong and mainland China, what are Invest Hong Kong's upcoming plans for attracting investment from enterprises in the Greater Bay Area?
We work very closely with the Greater Bay Area authorities, and because Hong Kong, like I said earlier, is a jumping board. So for companies who want to come through Hong Kong into China, we work closely with the Greater Bay Area authorities to do a lot of investment promotion events, as well as to advise companies as to why settlement in Hong Kong would give them a benefit rather than, say, going directly into China, because Hong Kong has the international expertise that could guide them for something for them that might be a different culture from their home country. And the Greater Bay Area has a lot of opportunities and work together with Hong Kong. For example, you could set up an R&D function in Hong Kong, but have the actual manufacturing in China. So work very closely together.
Now, in terms of providing information to the public sector and to the business industry specifically, media plays an important role, right? Invest Hong Kong and RTHK recently co-produced a new documentary series which specifically targets potential foreign and mainland investors. So could you tell us more about the key points of this program?
Hong Kong is a premier business hub in Asia. Overseas...
We have, in collaboration with RTHK, produced a series of 8 episodes of programs showcasing the successful cases where Invest Hong Kong helped companies come into Hong Kong to establish the business, ranging from startups to multinational size companies. They cover areas such as professional services, creative industries, food and beverage, and many other industries. You will see the successful cases of companies that have come in and to share how they were helped by Invest Hong Kong along the way.
Well, I'm sure having solid cases, you know, showing the audience really helps them gain more confidence in starting a business in Hong Kong.
Yeah, definitely it'll be very inspirational. We'll be looking forward to that series for sure. Thank you, Alpha, for sharing your strategic plans to boost foreign and mainland investment in Hong Kong. And don't forget to tune in to Hong Kong Business Made Easy every Saturday at 7:30 p.m. on RTHK TV 31 to hear the success stories of foreign and mainland enterprises that have put down roots in our city.
One of Hong Kong's greatest strengths is its ability to fuse the old with the new. The fashion designer we're about to meet merges traditional Chinese clothing with contemporary design to create captivating garments that perfectly embody this trait.
I've tried on so many outfits. You know what they all seem to have in common? Don't you think that these clothes all possess a blend of contemporary elements while exhibiting traditional Chinese aesthetics? But what specific elements would give a garment the resemblance of a traditional Chinese attire? Let's ask the designer. Hello, Janko. What specific elements would make a piece of garment seem like traditional Chinese clothing?
Actually, traditional Chinese clothing has a few important features, including the collar, front opening, buttons, sleeve style, and the cutting. The most unique feature of traditional Chinese clothing is the T-shaped structure of the interconnected shoulders and the flat cutting. The cutting is flat, meaning that the front and back pieces are made from the same piece of the fabric, and the left and right piece are joined together with the collar and the buttons to create a garment. However, the everyday clothing we wear has a three-dimensional cutting, meaning there are the shoulder seam or the waist duct.
Why do you have special fondness for traditional Chinese clothing?
When I finished the study fashion design, I started working at a TV station. I need to deal with many different styles of the clothing for the different Chinese dynasties. I found that during my design studies, I have never really been exposed to traditional Chinese clothing. As I studied into it, I found that it holds a lot of history and culture. I believe these culturally rich designs are not only beautiful, but also worth promoting.
How about you show me your design and tell us more about the different elements of traditional Chinese clothing?
Yes.
This top exhibits daring color choices paired with a traditional angle placket design. This shirt is paired with a horse hoof cuff, which is not too extra. The jacket denim jacket features a Chinese-style collar and buttons with a flat cutting techniques that exude an oriental aesthetic.
And finally, the qipao. We all know that qipao is the most popular and enduring traditional Chinese outfit. Can you tell us more about it?
Qipao, which is a type of chuanzang, is a style of Chinese women's dress, which became popular in the 1920s. 1950s was the golden era for the qipao in Hong Kong. Influenced by Western culture, master tailors combined Western-style techniques, such as three-dimensional cutting. This helped making the qipao fit better and show off the body's beauty.
There are other frequently seen types of Chinese attire, the cheongsam, which gained popularity in the 1920s and 1930s. The magua is a jacket worn over the cheongsam, often associated with the beloved cartoon character, Old Master Q. And this da jing san, a right button unlined garment, is a traditional Hakka women wear. In kung fu movies, men often sport the duan da, a simple cross-collar upper garment. Lastly, the Chinese tunic suit that adds a scholarly and cultured touch to one's appearance. To promote the culture of traditional Chinese clothing, Zhenko started teaching people how to make traditional Chinese clothing in 2015. She offers both online and offline courses, attracting overseas Chinese and foreigners who are interested in learning. I don't have enough time today to make one, but I can try making a pair of flower buttons.
After talking with Zhenko, we agreed that the best way to promote and preserve the culture of Chinese attire is to wear it every day. Like Maggie Chang in the movie, In the Mood for Love, wear it at work or even grabbing takeout, add a touch of elegance and appreciation for Chinese attire. Don't you think it's a brilliant idea?
Rico, have you noticed that recently there have been more and more movies and TV shows about the multiverse? The idea that there are other versions of us scattered across different timelines is both intriguing and mind-boggling.
I couldn't agree more, Mishy. Time travel and parallel universes are popular themes not only in film and television, but also literature and art. As a matter of fact, there is a psychedelic exhibition currently running at Tai Kwun, which brings the past and future together.
You must be referring to Warring States Cyberpunk by Hong Kong animation artist Kongkee. Featuring large-scale LED installations and neon works, it's an immersive experience that combines art and technology.
That's right. Let's see how Kongkee has transformed Tai Kwun into a cyberpunk universe where the legendary poet Qu Yuan has been brought back to life.
Dragon's Delusion is an animation project started in 2017 by Kong Hong Chang, also known as Kongkee. It's about the patriotic poet of the True Kingdom, Qu Yuan, being resurrected and catapulted into a cyberpunk dystopian future. While the animated film is yet to be finished, it's already taken Kongkee all the way to the other side of the world and back.
Our goal is made feature-length movie of Dragon's Delusion and leading by Hong Kong creative force. But actually, we are not like other developed animation countries like Japan or US that they got a lot of manpower or the distribution channel. We have to fight for it. We along the way, we keep cooperate with other artists. So we trying to use these methods to keep the project going.
Since the preface of Dragon's Delusion won the gold mention at DigiCon 6 Asia in Japan in 2017, the universe of this animated movie has sparked the interest of many artists and organizations, spawning numerous art pieces, concerts, exhibitions, as well as a range of merchandise.
This is a homecoming exhibition from the Chicago Asian Art Museum. And in this series, we have a new exhibition in Hong Kong this time. Kongkee Warring State Cyberpunk is an exhibition about a platform we are trying to build up for a conversation between the present and the past.
Some of the biggest installations here at the Duplex Studio were developed specifically for the gallery at Tai Kwun. Visitors will be enthralled the moment they step inside, as they find themselves immersed in the psychedelic lighting of this large-scale LED work.
When we visit this place, it feels like a church, so we like to transform these feelings into a cinema. Past, present, future, bleeding, tearing, and drifting, which is an expression from my feeling towards the mankind, the humanity situation today when we get in touch with the audience from San Francisco, in US, and in Hong Kong. We found that actually, even though we are separated, but our experience is connected. We got a lot of trauma, histories, cultural struggle, that actually we can understand each other, even though that we are from different culture. Everyone is an island, but actually, when you know the other is isolated, just like you, then it's strange, you're feeling a little bit better that you are not that isolated.
On the second floor, there's another commissioned piece which Kongkee created in collaboration with a local neon light craftsman.
The time flows and we are only living in a very short time. The reason that we perceive the mountain is very stable. Actually, mountain and ocean are the same, they flow all the time. In Dragon's Delusion, we specifically set the stage in Warring State period, which like this is a period that the explosion of technology and philosophy. There are many thinkers, philosophers that were born in that age and influencing us for many years until now. Nowadays, we got an explosion of technology. We got AI now. The new technology is replacing the old one. The new system is replacing the old system. Under this kind of situation, people will get a lot of suffering because they're losing their power. They have to learn new stuff. It's hard for people to adapt to a new age. In our exhibition, the theme is also about how people struggle in nowadays, this cyberpunk world is all about high tech and low life. And that's why neon light become a very important symbol in our works.
Come join the search for the humanistic spirit in this immersive cyberpunk experience from now until March 3rd.
Continuing on the topic of art, the 52nd edition of the Hong Kong Arts Festival will officially open on the 22nd of February. Featuring over 150 performances, this year's program promises a mix of timeless classics and groundbreaking new works.
Ms. Grace Lang, Program Director of HKAF, is here to tell us more about the festival as well as its offerings this year. Welcome to Vibrant Hong Kong.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here.
Welcome. Now, I believe that most people have heard of the Hong Kong Arts Festival, but could you tell us more about what kind of programs it presents and also its history?
Yes, in fact, we started in 1973. That was our first festival. And we present different genres of art, ballet, contemporary dance, classical music, jazz, world music, theatre, English theatre, Cantonese theatre, so you name it, we have it. Basically, we'll be using the cultural centre in Tsim Sha Tsui, City Hall in Central, and the Academy for Performing Arts in Wan Chai, as well as other venues like the Tai Kwun in Central, and even the Nan Lian Garden in Diamond Hill. So it's quite interesting for the audience to explore the festival in different ways.
It would be great activities to go as a family or with friends.
I'm sure it's going to help us, you know, discover the hidden gems of Hong Kong as well.
Now I would like to know is, what are your usual criteria in terms of selecting which artists to work with or deciding just what kind of program that you want to present each year?
Well, they have to be the best, the highest quality, because we have the festival only once a year. 5 weeks, we have lots of artists coming from different countries.
Well, it's really probably once-in-a-lifetime experience for all these international artists to gather, you know, at this point in time. So as we mentioned earlier, this year's festival will officially open later this month. So could you tell us what the theme is and also give us a preview of the program?
Well, we have different themes. Like in the first week, very special program is on climate change. So this one theme is a Canadian-American artist. She will be doing animated theatre shows for the family, for children. The second one, it's on the interactive technology. We have Van Gogh in me. It's a choir and Van Gogh and Klimt's paintings in a concert setting, which is very unusual. And then we have the traditional theatre plays, operas, the Chinese opera, Beijing opera, Kwun opera, Ping Tan, Cantonese opera. And we have a Shanghai ballet from Shanghai with the dancers in Cheongsam's. So something quite different.
That's so exciting.
I have a feeling the Van Gogh performance is going to be my favorite. But, you know, I love music. I also have a background in Cantonese opera, so there's just too much to choose from. But I do know that you have got some video clips for us to check out right now, right?
Yes.
Let's take a look.
That looks really amazing. So can you tell us about some of the key highlights of this year's program?
This festival, we are working with the Bavarian State Opera from Munich. So the whole opera company is coming to Hong Kong to perform in the first week of the festival as the opening festival program. And they are bringing Strauss, Ariane of Naxos, which is an very interesting opera. It's like a music theater with ballet at the beginning and then the drama and the opera arias and all the acting. So it's an exciting opera for our audience. It's rarely performed, but we are bringing the opera house. The second collaborator is La Scala Ballet. They are bringing a timeless classic, Le Corsaire, which is this pirate to us. The La Scala Ballet is very well known, really the top ballet companies in the world. So I hope the audience will really grasp this opportunity to come to the festival.
It's no easy work to bring together so many, you know, different artists, top artists from around the world, and you probably have to serve as a mediator sometimes. And of course, you know, world-class artists always have very demanding schedules. So can you help us understand the specific challenges of, you know, HKAF and of course Grace yourself being the host of all these different artists?
Well, because most of them travel all the way to Hong Kong, they would love to establish a tour. So we have to work out the schedule, which is a very challenging experience for everyone in the festival. So lining up all these stops together with the agents, with other presenters all over the world, and getting everything fixed, because we don't have venues, we have to rent the venues and to fit the performances back to back in order not to waste any days of performances. This is really the beauty of having a festival.
Well, I'm sure despite all the challenges, this is why it's so worth it, you know, to host an arts festival in Hong Kong. So in addition to introducing artists and performance groups from around the world to Hong Kong audiences, I understand that HKAF is also dedicated to promoting the local art scene. So could you tell us a bit about your work in this area?
Well, this time we have a very interesting project with group Cantonese Opera. It's a new commission. It's called The Oracle. It's a myth, you know, common people and the gods. So how they interact, how they kind of travel, and how they perceive, you know, their destiny. So that's something I think challenging for thoughts and for the audience. So this is one project. And then there is another project, is musical, I Am What I Am. We are having the Cantonese musical premiere at the festival, where we had already the Putonghua version at the Guangzhou Grand Theatre. And then there is another concert called Garden of Repose, which is a special project at West Kowloon with the local singers, vocalists, and multimedia artists. So we have a
very
diverse
program.
Due to the venue capacity limitations, I'm sure a show can only accommodate a certain number of spectators. So does the festival offer any activities that would allow it to reach a wider audience? So what are your plans this year?
Well, we have a lot of talks, film showings, behind the scene, walks even. There's a walk to
walking
the cemetery. So all related to the programs we are presenting. And then we have a Hong Kong Arts Festival at Dai Kwun in Central, which is a free event for the families and for the general public.
So HKAF is really taking over both the cyberspace and, you know, physical realm of performances. Now, education is essential when it comes to cultivating interest in art appreciation. So could you share with us how HKAF actively expands its audience base, since you previously mentioned that there are programs that appeal to the youth?
We have secondary school students, university students joining us as young friends. They could attend performances, they could attend the workshops, individual members or school members, university members. So it's a really wonderful project for the youth to encounter the arts in different ways.
Well, big thanks to HKAF for all the work that you're doing promoting the art scene in Hong Kong. And of course, Grace, for telling us all about the Hong Kong Arts Festival and all the programs that are available this year. And if you do want to check out what's in store, be sure to visit the HKAF official website.
And photography is also a form of artistic expression. A British photographer based in Hong Kong is currently holding an exhibition that explores the overlooked corners of our city. So let's journey into these vanishing vistas together.
the neon lights of Nathan Road, the sunset in Tayo, and the view of Central from Victoria Peak have captured the heart of countless photographers. But what sets apart the beauty of Hong Kong? Today, I'm meeting Stefan, a photojournalist from the UK, who will take us on a journey to explore the beauty within desolation. In recent years, Stefan has embarked on a project titled Abandoned Villages of Hong Kong. Today, he'll join me in exploring the outskirts of the city to discover abandoned houses.
It's strange how the rear section of the house is completely caved in and the glass windows are still there, still intact.
And we can see the two floors, the second floor is still there.
You can see the sort of architectural style of the classic village house.
Stefan's captivating work has been exhibited in various locations such as New York, London and Hong Kong. Additionally, his photographs have garnered global recognition and have been featured in renowned publications, including the New York Times and National Geographic. Hello, Stefan. Thank you so much for bringing us here. It's a very beautiful village here. Can you tell us, when did you start photographing these abandoned villages and houses? And is there any specific event or place that inspired you to undertake the project?
Sure. I started this project in 2019, but actually the first photograph that inspired me was back in 2012 in a village called Sa Kok Mei, and that's near to Sai Kung in the New Territories. There was one house in particular which was ruined and the roof had collapsed and vegetation was growing out of the front door. So it looked very, very attractive to me and I took a photograph very casually that day. And then many years later, when I'm looking back through my archive of pictures, I came across this picture again and I thought, oh, this could be an interesting topic for a whole project. So then in 2019, I started to photograph more intensively. And since then, I've visited more than 30 different villages all over the New Territories of Hong Kong and the islands.
What do you find so attractive about these abandoned houses?
I think a lot of people may relate to it when you've been hiking in Hong Kong and you sometimes come across a hidden surprise of a ruined house in the countryside. And I think the interaction with nature and the old houses, the way that Hong Kong used to be in the past, I think that's what really appeals to me and hopefully to other people. The weather here is very harsh and the humidity, and then it affects the way that the houses look and the way the paint is peeling. And then the result, I think, is quite beautiful. I managed to find some villagers who used to live in the village in various parts of Hong Kong, and I conducted interviews with them and found out more about their experience of living in the village house. And the result has been some very heartwarming essays and stories. It gives the photographs more context and more of a connection to the people that once lived here.
Today, Stefan had a successful time taking pictures with us. But it's important to note that exploring abandoned villages can often present challenging conditions. Sometimes the buildings are extensively damaged. Other times, they are heavily overgrown with wild vegetation. And occasionally, the structures may even be completely gone. Therefore, careful planning of the itinerary is essential to navigate these obstacles and ensure a rewarding experience.
I prepare for each shoot usually by going online, as simple as looking at Google Maps, look for villages that look suitable for abandoned sites and for photography. I usually travel very light with a small camera and plenty of water. And sometimes when I finally get to the location, maybe the village is actually not worth photographing because it could be completely in ruins or completely overgrown with plants and vegetation. So it's a bit of a hit and miss situation. Sometimes I can get really pleasantly surprised with great, great photographs. And sometimes it's go back home and start again.
Stefan recently held a photography exhibition in Shenwen, showcasing his photographs of abandoned village houses in Hong Kong taken in recent years. The exhibition will run until February 25th, and anyone interested is welcome to visit.
All those beautiful photos remind us of the hidden beauty that lies within the forgotten places in Hong Kong. Exploring some of these stunning locations is definitely an option worth considering if you're staying in town for the upcoming Chinese New Year holidays.
Speaking of Chinese New Year, I better get started on the festive preparations. I need to make turnip cakes, buy sweets for the candy box, and hang up decorations around the house.
But Rico, don't forget the most important thing of all, my red packet!
Don't worry, Mishy, I'll get that organized as soon as I get home. But before that, let's say goodbye to our viewers. Thank you for watching tonight. See you next week.
Good night. Good night.